I want you to turn in your Bible to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. Thanks, guys. I really appreciate that. You guys did a great job. Did a great job. Luke chapter 1. Now, the message God has for us today is a message that is important for us to understand about the birth of a Savior. And how it came about. Now see, last week we talked about significance in the name. We talked about power in the name of Jesus. Did we not, church? As I was praying with the Holy Spirit, you know, with God's leadership on the message this morning, I was reminded that, you know, God is always, always looking for His children to work in His kingdom, to serve in His kingdom. And what greater picture than what we're going to see this morning with Mary? Mary was willing to do what God called her to do. You know, there's no other woman that will be able to say what Mary said. She birthed the Son of Jesus. She did with the Holy Spirit what God asked her to do. As I start this message this morning, I want to ask you this. How many of you this morning would be willing to do what God calls you to do? How many of you would be willing this morning to do what God calls you to do? Let me tell you where I come to this. As we were meeting Friday night with Pastor Mike and Susan, it was interesting. Susan had no idea this question was coming. Pastor Mike looked across. She says, "When did you know Marty had been called to be a pastor?" Oh, man, I'm going to tell you, I knew what was getting ready to open up there. Because Susan didn't know until that Sunday morning, the Holy Spirit pressed upon my heart, "Marty, it's time." I may have mentioned to you that I had battled with this about a year, you know, and struggling with the Lord. "Lord, I know you want me to do this, but I really don't want to do it. I don't think I'm worthy. I don't think I should. And you know, you're miserable when you don't do what God wants you to do. And I got up on that Sunday morning, didn't say a word to Sunday. In fact, it was kind of funny hearing Susan share the story with Mike the other night. She says, "I didn't know we were having marital problems. Marty just got up and walked to the altar." I'm thinking, what's going on in our marriage? Is everything okay? I mean, he didn't tell me nothing. And then she thought, well, maybe it's something he did and I don't know about it, you know. So, and then it was interesting because, of course, Susan and I joke around about this now. But, and then Pastor Art Beal, when he, after we prayed in front of the church and then turned around, First Baptist Church of Monticello was where I was ordained as well. And he said, "Church, I want to announce to you that Marty has answered the call to preach." And I'll never forget looking back, and about the fourth or fifth row back, we sat in the front of the church. And looking back at the fourth or fifth row, and I saw Susan's face, like, "What?" You know, it's interesting, and Dan, you can appreciate this. The Lord doesn't call us at the same time. Susan said, "The Lord didn't call me to be no pastor's wife." But I'm going to tell you something, church. She's the best pastor's wife I've ever known. The only one I'll ever know. But here's where I'm going with this. You know, there are so many times in our life that we struggle with what God wants us to do. Listen to me this morning. When you do what God wants you to do, there's no longer the struggle. There comes the blessing. Are you listening to me? If you want to really be blessed, then do what God's called you to do. "Marty, I don't want to go to a foreign mission field." Maybe the Lord is impressed in your heart, and there's just this country the Lord keeps bringing to mind, and He's saying, "I want to use you." And you say, "No, I don't want to go there. I'll pray for them." You know, maybe the Lord's impressed upon your heart to go there. Maybe He's impressed upon your part to be a part of helping them financially. I don't know, but you know, because the Lord has impressed it upon your heart. He said, "Well, Pastor, will you pray with me?" Yes, I'll pray with you. And I've mentioned several times before, so many people pray for years about something they know the Lord has called them to do. Maybe it's time that you get up and do what God's calling you to do. You know, sometimes when we pray for something, God has already given us the answer. What you're doing is praying that God will take the answer away and give you a different one. Amen? So when people say to me, Marty, I'm praying about whether the Lord wants me to serve there. No, not really. What they're doing is praying about whether the Lord wants to find somebody else, not them. Isn't that true? Come on, be honest with me. Isn't that true? Yeah. I remember doing that from time to time. I remember when the pastor used to come up to me, Marty, I believe the Lord's given you a gift. Would you be willing to do this? And I would say, I'll pray about it. Pastor would come back 3 or 4 months later. Marty, how do you feel about it? Have you been praying about that? I would say, yeah, I've been praying about it. The whole time I'm praying, Lord, it's fine. There's got to be somebody else that can do this. Somebody else. Follow along with me this morning in Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1, picking up at verse number 26. And here we go. And this is what it says. Now, remember how I tell you guys so many times that it's important for you to mark in your Bible? Anybody that ever wants to take a look at my Bible, you will find that I've got stuff written everywhere. And sometimes it's been written from years ago, and I'll have to put on not just my glasses, but I'll have to put on 2 pair of glasses because I can't see what I wrote back years ago when I could see a little bit better. So I encourage you to put notes in your Bible. Here we go. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. This is now in the 6th month. The angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city in Galilee called Nazareth. Now, here's what I want you to do. I want to dissect these verses for you, okay? Now, in the 6th month, what does that mean? The 6th month of history, 6th month of the month. I mean, what does that mean? What does it mean in the 6th month? What was the Gabriel? What was the time frame here? What was going on? Anybody know? This is my Sunday school class this morning, so you help me out, class. 6th month of what? A 6th month of Elizabeth's pregnancy. Who knows who Elizabeth is? Elizabeth is the mother of John the Baptist. There you go, church. Now write that out in the margin of your Bible. In the 6th month, now listen, the angel was coming to Mary during the 6th month of the pregnancy of Elizabeth, because it's important for us to understand Elizabeth was not supposed to have kids. She was a barren woman. You understand what that means? Means she could not have children. So the angel is going to come to Mary and share with Mary what is about to take place in her life. And the angel will use what is happening with Elizabeth to prove the miracle that God can do. Now, I just pause here for a moment because I want to set the tone. Isn't it amazing that when God calls us to do something, He will as well share with us how He has done miracles in the lives of others to encourage us, to let us know, hey, listen, now listen, I'm not calling you just out of the blue here and just think that you're the only one that God can do a miracle in. Are you with me, church? If God's calling you to do something, He's calling you because He will equip you. He will open the doors for you to do what He's called you to do. It's pretty quiet in here. Are you listening to me, church? You see, many people say, well, listen, I'll do what God wants me to do when He equips me, when He gives me the ability to do it. God could care less about your ability. You know what God wants? God wants your availability. He wants your willingness and your humility to do what He's called you to do. He will equip you. He will make you able to do what He wants you to do. Amen?
Amen.
Good. All right, let's go. Here we go. Look here. So, in the 6th month, the angel goes to Mary. Now, notice this is important. I want you to catch this. Verse 27, it says, to a virgin. Here's what I want you to do. Put a little one in your Bible above that. Just a little one. Will you? So, Marty, really? I'm going to write in my Bible? Absolutely. Put a little one. To a virgin. Now, notice this. I just need to pause here. It says in verse number 26, the angel was sent from God to a city in Galilee called Nazareth. Notice that it doesn't say to Mary. We're going to get to that. Now, you would think that if you're going to go see someone, what would you do? You would call them by their name first. Amen, church? Listen, the angel was coming to see Marty. The angel was coming to see Susan. The angel was coming to see Dan. The angel was coming to see Mary. That's not what happens here in Scripture. Notice this. The angel is sent to, first, number one, a what? We're going to see the identifiers of who Mary is. And it's important for us to see this because what the Scripture is telling us, that God is trying to say to us, I'm making sure you understand this isn't just Mary. I am sending the angel to a virgin. Not only to a virgin, notice this, but I'm also sending the angel to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph. Therefore, she was not what? Married. She's a virgin and she was not married. She's engaged to a man whose name is Joseph. Now, here's the third part. Who is the descendant of who? David. Which is the prophetic lineage, the line for where the Savior would come from, to go all the way back into history. Amen, church? So the identifiers come out in three places before Mary's name is ever mentioned. She's a virgin. She's engaged. She's not married. And by the way, who she's engaged to falls in line with the lineage of where the King of Kings would come from, Jewish descent. So here we go. I'll move on a little forward. So we have the identifiers to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the descendants of David. And the And the virgin's name is Mary. Isn't that amazing? You ever notice that in Scripture? The Word of God took time to tell us about the miracle that was going to take place before the name was even mentioned. And who she was and where she was to come from, because it was going to fulfill the prophecy. By the way, anybody know what the name Mary means? You want to write out, again, the parentheses of your Bible? It means excellence. I'm going to tell you some more things about Mary in just a moment. So we see here the identifiers of who Mary is. Now we see a greeting come from the angel. We have, okay, this is what the angels do. This is where the angel's going, who the angel's going to see. Now let's see the greeting that comes to Mary. And coming in, he, the angel, Gabriel, says to Mary, "Greetings, favored one." Now, I don't know about you, wouldn't it just be wonderful if God would send a messenger from heaven today and say to you, Jim, "Greetings, favored one." Now, I don't know about you, but how many of you would probably see what Mary's going to say here in just a moment? What do you mean, favored one? Now, that would be a wonderful thing to have an angel from God come and say, "Favored one." But how many of you right now feel as if you're the favored one? Yeah, right? So notice this. Look at here. "Greetings, favored one." Notice the exclamation mark. It's an emphasis on what Mary is and who she is and how that this, listen to me, write this. If you want to write this in the margin of your Bible, I did. I put that God found a diamond amongst the black felt. God found a diamond amongst the black felt. Of all of the women in the world, God picked out one and said, "Mary, you're favored." He found the diamond. How many of you want to be the diamond that God would use because of your walk and your relationship with God? Look here. "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." Can you just imagine having a walk with God that He would send His angel not only to say that you are favored of God, but to say that the Lord is with you? You know what a blessing it would be just to have someone on the street walk up and say, "Dan, I just want you to know the Lord is with you." To know that my countenance, His countenance, would reflect the righteousness of God. Amen, church? Amen. He goes and he says, "The Lord is with you." Verse number 29. But she was, now underline this, very perplexed at this statement. And kept pondering, underline that, and kept pondering what kind of salutation this was. I would dare say that this was the first time that Mary had ever been visited by an angel from heaven. And I don't know about you, but I would be perplexed, and I would be pondering that salutation too, as many of you would. Number one, shocked and amazed and probably scared to death that an angel of heaven would even appear to you. And then to hear the comment that you are favored among God, that He is with you. Many of us would wonder, well, is there anything that I have done? Does my countenance reflect my relationship with Christ? So Mary was curious. She was perplexed. She was in amazement. How was it that of all the women in the world, this angel came to her? How was it that of all the women in the world, this angel says to her that she is favored with God? Let's go on. Now, I love this part in verse number 30, because I could just picture how I would be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid." I think that's an understatement. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid, Mary, for you, again, notice the angel says this again, for you have found favor with God. This diamond amongst all that black felt, she had found favor with God. Why? You ever thought about what favor it was she might have found with God outside of her walk? Let's just talk about this just for a moment. How many of you would agree with me that Mary would have been a woman of moral character? You agree with me on that? Now, ladies, men, look up here. Do we live in a world today of moral character? Do we live in a time today, remember I preached this message on the Church of Laodicea, do we live in a time today where moral character is an afterthought? Do we live in a time today where morality has become desensitized to us? Yes or no? How many of you parents understand and realize and pay attention to what your children are being taught in school? I think it was in the state of Colorado. I think it's in Colorado. I may have the state wrong. Mike and I were just talking about this Friday night, where they're trying to tell children, don't worry about calling yourself a boy or a girl. You can be a purple penguin. I'm serious. You go look it up. I never thought I would live to see when my child would go to school, and I've got 6 grandkids, and they would never be considered the gender that they are, that they would be classified as purple penguins. Well, let me tell you something. The creation of a penguin knows what he is. The penguin knows whether he's male and female. Do you not know that, church? Amen? Now, here's something very important for us to understand. Mary was selected by God because she was a woman of moral character. I want God to use me in an amazing way. How about you, church? And I want my relationship with Him to be one of moral character. You see, my moral character may not agree with the political climate of today. But let me tell you something, my moral character will be in line with this book. How about you, church? You see, I don't care what the world says. I don't care if it angers people. We have had people, yes, church, we have had people, since I have pastored churches, we have had people get up and walk out of the church because of what this book says. I'm okay with that. Because I am not going to change. Because when God looks at me, when God says, Marty, are you in a right relationship with me? He'll know because I am a man of moral character. Are you with me, church? Mike and I were talking about this Friday night. It has grown to an epidemic in our churches. Over 70% of the men in church, listen to me, over 70% of the men in church are messing around with pornography. In church! No, you're not doing it in church. You understand what I'm saying? Okay? What I'm saying is, privately, where they think nobody knows about it, let me tell you who knows about it. Man, listen to me. When God looks at you and you say you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, does He see your moral character? So, no, wait a minute, Marty, this is not a Christmas message. Yes, it is. Because the greatest gift that was ever sent was the Savior of the world to save us from the garbage that this world wants to throw at you. You see, the devil's responsibility, you know what he wants to do? He wants to steal and destroy your life. That's his mission. The greatest gift of all came to give you life. You say, well, Marty, I'm addicted to this. You're addicted to your desires. And let me tell you something. If you want freedom, let your desire go to Him. That's freedom. So Mary was a woman of moral character. You want God to do some amazing things in your life? Be a man and woman of moral character. I don't care what the world says. Go by what the book says. Number two, she was a woman of integrity. I believe that when Mary said she would do something, she did it. She was a woman of integrity. And we're going to see in just a moment, she was humble. She was humble. You know, it destroys a lot of great men in the ministry and women is when they begin to look at themselves as the greatest gift. Mike and I were sharing that. Again, you keep hearing me mention Mike, but it's not very often that I get a chance just to spend time with a pastor and just love on each other. And we both prayed for one another. Said, Lord, whatever you do in the ministry, please keep us humble that you will always be number one. The numbers about leading others to Christ is important to us, not about the numbers that sit in a chair. Keep us humble. Mary was humble, and we'll see that in just a moment. Now follow along with me. The angel said to her, Mary, do not be afraid, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Now it's one thing to have the angel come down and say, Mary, you're favored with God, and he's with you. But oh, by the way, Mary, I got to go on here. You see, you're going to conceive, and you're going to have a child, and he's going to be the Son of God. Now I don't know about you, how many of you women go, oh, wow. That's a lot to comprehend right there. I got the marry your. I'm just getting through the marry your favored part, but now I'm gonna what? I'm gonna have a child, and he's gonna be the who? Son of God? Really? Look here. Verse number 32. Oh, I love this part. Here's what the angel said. The angel not only tells her that she's going to conceive, she's going to have the Son of God, but oh, look at this. Verse number 32. He will be what, church? He will be great. Number 2. He will be called the Son of who? The Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, again setting up the lineage for who Jesus would be of Jewish descent, again to answer the prophecy of what had been foretold. Verse number 33, it says, and he will what? Reign over the house of Jacob. Again, the lineage of who Christ would be. And his kingdom, I love this part, and his kingdom will have no end. Any thought that we're talking about somebody else here? Any thought that this could be anybody? Anybody else? No. It's the one and only Jesus Christ. The one and only Son of God. Oh, I love this. Verse number 34. Now here we go. Mary said to the angel, how many of you just picture Mary right now? Her eyes wide open. And she's trying to grasp all of this. Come on, ladies, help me out. How many of you are visualizing this? Come on, ladies, you remember when you were told you were pregnant, don't you? This is like, really? Yeah, right? You remember those days? Now, can you imagine an angel coming to you and telling you that you're going to conceive? Look here. Mary says, how can this be since I'm a virgin? How many of you would consider that to be a legitimate question? Mary says, how can this be? Now I want you to picture this young woman, this young girl. She's very familiar with how this happens. In fact, she's going through the process, the culture of the betrothal part, the engagement part with Joseph. The purity of what a woman should be, that's part of that Jewish culture. And now she's hearing that she's going to have a child. And she thought, well, wait a minute. Joseph and I aren't even married. How can that be? She's trying to grasp what she knows. Would you not agree with me, church? How many of us at times when the Lord will call us to do something, we see it from this human perspective? We don't see it from what I call the ultimate out of touch, out of reality, out of mind, out of body. We don't see it from the reality of God, who can do what? Anything and everything he wants. Our finite mind just cannot grasp this. And poor Mary, her finite mind couldn't grasp what it was the angel was telling her. Notice this. She says, how can this be since I'm a virgin? She knew what she was. She knew that it was impossible for her to do this unless she had a relationship with Joseph. And she knew that was not going to happen because that was out of culture. That was not what they were supposed to do. Look at here. The angel said to her, now I can just picture the angel. Hold on, Mary. Now, by the way, I want you to understand, Mary wasn't saying this because she was doubting God. She wasn't saying this because she didn't believe God couldn't do it, because, again, let's understand, she was a follower. She loved the Lord. She was favored by God. She was just simply trying to grasp what it was that she was being told. So the angel says to her, you know what, I can just picture the angel. Well, let me explain this a little bit further. Isn't it amazing when God takes the time to explain what he wants to do? How many of you appreciate that? Lord, you know, you want me to preach. Now, you got to understand, here's my background, here's my past, and by the way, if you want me to preach, now you got to help me here. You got to call Susan, too. You got to let her know, and, you know. And isn't it amazing when the Lord says, just let me work all the details out. You just trust me, and let me work all the details out. So this is what's happening here. The angel says to her, the Holy Spirit, in other words, Mary, let me give you the details. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High, because the Son of God is going to be the Son of who? The Most High. So the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and for that reason, the Holy Child shall be called the Son of God. Now, I want to say something that's very important, because there's a lot of mythology out there that says, you know, there was a relationship with the Holy Spirit and Mary. No, 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 no. The Holy Spirit, boom, implanted the Son of God in Mary. Amen, church? It says that the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and you, for this reason alone, you will bear the Son of God. He will be notice what it says there, and I circled this in my Bible, the Holy Child. You know what Holy Child means? He is sinless. And he is sinless because Mary did not have a relationship with man, that God did a miracle in implanting Mary through the Holy Spirit with the Son of God. Amen, church? That is why we celebrate this time of year, because we know that the Lord Jesus Christ was sinless. He was the Son of God. Amen, church? He had to be. And then go on. And behold, even your relative Elizabeth has also conceived a son in her old age. And she who was called barren is now in her sixth month. Now this goes all the way back to the very first verse we started with. Would you not agree with me, church? The angel came to her in the sixth month. Now the angel is trying to say, okay, Mary, now hold on a minute. I know this is a lot. By the way, Mary, let me encourage you. Don't you just love it when the Lord encourages us? Mary, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to encourage you. Mary, you know Elizabeth. You know Elizabeth? Oh, yeah. Yeah, my relative. Mary, listen, right now she's 6 months pregnant. Now, what does Mary know about Elizabeth? Mary knows that she is barren, impossible. But yet God allowed her to have a son. Okay, now, I got to pause here. I want to take just a quick pause and a detour. Will you go to verse number 76? Because picking up right about verse 39, which we won't get to today, from verses 39 through the remainder of chapter 1 is where Mary goes to visit Elizabeth. She's going to see this thing that the Lord has done in Elizabeth. Verse number 76 is very important, because I want you to grasp something here. There's a difference between John the Baptist and Jesus Christ. Who can tell me what it is? Before we even read this verse, who can tell me? Jesus Christ is what? The Son of God. He's the Holy Child. Who is John the Baptist? John the Baptist was a prophet. John the Baptist was to lay the groundwork for Jesus Christ. Now here, I want you to see this. If you've never seen this before, you need to see this today. You need to underline this. Verse number 76, this is talking about John the Baptist, because remember Mary now in verse number 39, and again I'm taking a pause here, he's going to go visit to see this great thing that's happening with Elizabeth. In verse number 76 it says, and your child, this child, will be called the prophet of the Most High. Now wait a minute, what did we see that Jesus was going to be called? What was Jesus called? Listen, what was Jesus called? He was called the Son of the... Did you see that? Let's go back. Look here. It's important that you see this. Go back to these verses that we just read. Okay? Look here. Verse number 32, what did the angel tell Mary? He will be great, talking about Jesus, and he will be called the... Underline that, please. Jesus will be called the Son of the Most High. Go back to verse number 76. We're talking about John the Baptist, because Mary's going to go see Elizabeth, see this great thing that's happened in Elizabeth, this barren woman who could not have kids. She had a relationship with her husband. He is going to have the prophet of the Most High. Do you see that, church? Now, I don't know for you, but let's put this in a theological realm here. The Son of the Most High would be the only one that has the ability because he is sinless. The prophet of the Most High was conceived by natural ways. John the Baptist was conceived naturally. Are you with me, church? Do you get that? Do you get the miracle of what God has done? Amen, church? And what he's doing with Mary here, he's sharing with her, he says, hey, listen, I want you to understand that in this 6 month, that the one that was barren, your relative Elizabeth, has naturally conceived, and her son will be the forerunner. He will be the prophet of the Son of God. Amen, church? That's just all part of the incredible miracle of Christmas. Now, verse 37, underline it. Underline it. Verse 37, for nothing will be impossible with God. Well, what's not impossible? Well, it wasn't impossible for Elizabeth to have a child, was it? A barren woman. Wasn't impossible for God to do that, was it, church? Absolutely not. And therefore, it's not impossible for this virgin whose name is Mary to have the Son of God. How many believe in miracles? How many of you believe that when God says he can do it, he can do it? Do you know what salvation... Now listen, I need to make sure that I clarify salvation for a moment. I believe there are a lot of people today who think they are saved. Now I'm going to be very tender in how I say this. The Word of God says, in fact, I want you to help me find it. It doesn't talk anywhere in the Word of God about praying a prayer to be saved. Somebody find it for me. If you find it, you let me know. You're not going to find it. The Word of God says that we accept salvation. We receive salvation because we, how many know the word? One simple word. It begins with a B. We believe. We believe. Well, what do we believe? Well, first and foremost, I believe in the miracle of the incarnation, the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. I believe that because without the virgin birth, without believing that God performed the miracle in the Son of God being born of a virgin, he was sinless, he was perfect, spotless Lamb of God. Without that, without believing that, then how can I believe that the perfect spotless Lamb of God could go to a cross and shed his perfect spotless blood for my sins? Are you with me, church? Salvation is based upon believing what Jesus did for me. Are you with me, church? There are many people that I think get caught up in a moment. There are many people that I believe to say, well, you know, Jesus, I want you to save me, blah, 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 and they walk out the door. They never believed that Jesus Christ was their Lord and Savior. Are you with me, church? The Word of God says that Satan knows who Jesus is, but he doesn't believe that he's the Savior of the world. Are you with me, church? So this morning, I want you to ask yourself, do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior and that Jesus Christ alone is the only one that can provide salvation for you? Because, my friend, if you believe that, you are saved. Are you with me, church? You have to believe that. You have to believe that there is no other way but Jesus Christ. And if anybody says anything different, anybody preaches anything different, they ain't preaching this. There is no other way. Last week we talked about power in the name of Jesus Christ, and the power in the name of Jesus Christ comes for salvation. Do you remember what the angel told Joseph? He said, you will name him Jesus because he will save the people from their sins. Going to save what people? The people who call upon the name of Jesus Christ and believe that He is the Son of God and believe that He is the only one that has the power to save. That is the gift of Christmas. Amen or oh me. Amen, church. The power unto salvation. So when I get on my knees and I come before the Lord, I say to Him, Lord, I receive You now as my Lord and Savior because I what, church? I believe that You're the only way. I believe that You're the only one that has the power to save. I believe that You died on the cross for my sins. I want you to ask yourself this morning, do you believe? Well, I love the way the angel just gives this wonderful burst of encouragement to Mary. I want you to follow along as we wrap this up. And Mary said, oh, I love this. Mary said, behold, thy bondservant. She says, behold, thy bondservant. Does this not exemplify who Mary is? Amen, church? She says, behold, your bondservant. How many of you this morning would be willing to look up to the Lord and say, Lord, behold your servant. Whatever, Lord, You would call me to do, whatever, Lord, You ask me to do, I will do it. I may not understand it. It may not make sense to me. It may not make sense to the world. But, Lord, whatever it is You called me to do, I will do it. It may anger somebody. It may even separate me from my family. But, Lord, whatever You call me to do, I'll do it. That's what Mary said. She says, look at here. She says, behold thy bondservant. I serve You, Lord. Whatever. Notice this. Behold thy bondservant, O Lord. May it be done. And she goes on, according to Your will. Do you know what Mary was saying here? You know what she was saying? Listen to me, church. She was saying she understood what her life was about to become. We've sung that song, Mary, Did You Know? And I'm sure that young girl right there did not grasp the fact, did not understand what was being meant when the angel said that He would save the people from their sins. Mary, at that very moment, understood that she had been chosen by God to do something incredibly special, and that was to birth the Son of God. At that very moment, Mary knew that her life would forever change as a young girl. She knew that, first and foremost, the angel would go and explain this to Joseph, but I'm sure in her mind, will Joseph still love me? This young man that she was betrothed to and engaged to, she knew that there was a possibility she could lose the very man that she loved by what she was willing to do for God. Isn't it amazing? God had already planned that out, didn't He not? She was willing. By the way, the Word of God says that Joseph loved her and he took her away because he knew what was getting ready to happen to her. You know, because of the culture, a pregnant woman who was not married could be stoned to death. Do you think Mary knew that? Yeah. But Mary said, behold thy bondservant. May it be done. I wrote in my notes here, she didn't compromise. She didn't say, well, no, listen, can we talk about this in 6 months? Do you know, Lord, hey, don't we do that? Don't we as Christians do that? Don't we say, wait a minute, Lord, I think that's a really cool idea. And you know what, I'm all for it, but now's not good timing. You know, Lord, financially I can't do it right now. Or, Lord, you know, listen, this just happened with a house, or we got stuff going on with the kids, or you know what, I don't know what the issue is. But the bottom line is, we want to compromise with God, do we not? We're willing to do it, but not right now. Maybe later. And Lord, maybe if we do it later, You'll forget about it. That's not what Mary said. Mary said, may it be so. According to Your will. In other words, Lord, whatever it is You're going to do, I'm Your bondservant. You do it. Now, I could get really choked up here. You know why? Because there were so many times in my life that I knew that God wanted me to do things, and I put Him off. And you see, when we put God off, or when we do something contrary to God's will, do you know we miss out on the blessings God has for us? See, Mary didn't know the whole picture yet. She's just like you and just like me. Maybe in a few months, God will open up the opportunity for me to preach the message called The Puzzle. I preached it many years ago, and it's simply this, just the groundwork, and it goes with what we're talking about. You see, Mary didn't know the whole picture. She had not grasped yet what had been said to Joseph, that he would be the Savior of the world. But I will tell you this, that had Mary known all of that, Mary would have still done what God called her to do. Because at that moment, Mary didn't know that that baby that was going to be the Son of God, 33 years later, would be nailed on a cross. And that she would be kneeling at the cross, looking at her son, as he did exactly what the Father sent him to do. No greater gift than the gift of Christmas in what Jesus did for you and for me. What an incredible story about an incredible woman who is an example of who we should be as followers of Jesus Christ. Amen, church? Amen. God can do the impossible in your life. Let him do it.